Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Towards You, two nights of choral concerts produced by the Portland State Choirs during the winter academic quarter of 2021 during the COVID-19 epidemic. Tonight, you're going to hear from the Portland State Chamber Choir, and tomorrow night, you'll get to hear from the Rose Choir and the Thorn Choir. The Chamber Choir had an unusual quarter because there's 40 of us in the choir, and for most of the quarter, we weren't allowed to all meet in the same room. We had to rehearse in two groups of 20. So I chose a lot of music for double choir, two choirs that sing back and forth. And we actually rehearsed these two choirs separately and really only met right before the recording session to do the videos for these concerts. I was hoping all along that COVID cases would ease and that 25-person cap would be lifted. And it was just before the end of the quarter. And I'm so grateful to St. Mary's Catholic Church in Mount Angel, Oregon, which is not only large enough to have 40 singers distance and sing together, but has exquisite acoustics. And thanks to them for letting us have that church. You're going to see the first three numbers sung there. Also, a huge thank you to Peter Simon and Spencer Rutledge from PSU's University Communications. They're the two videographers. They were the camera people for most of these videos and did all the editing and the assembly for all of this. So a huge thank you to them, and especially to Andrew Kent, our audio engineer. He's been our audio engineer for the past 11 years, ever since I took over at PSU, and fought through trying to record a choir, which is not a loud instrument, in these rooms where we have to keep the air conditioning and all these extra air filters going full blast because of COVID. And he's really done his best to mix all these unusual situations the best he can, and I think with great results. And finally, I want to thank the students in the choirs who have persevered and decided to continue their education in person, because choir does not work well on Zoom. These concerts over the next two nights are coming to you free. But if you would like to support someone, I mean, yes, it costs us some money to produce these concerts, but what I'd like you to do is to consider supporting them. You'll see a link on your screen. It'll appear a few times over the course of the night. You can donate by following this link, or you can actually text a number on your phone. And any money that you give tonight or tomorrow or whenever you're watching this video will go directly to the students in form of scholarships and will be totally tax deductible to you. So please consider supporting our students who are really trying to continue education at one of the hardest times to try to do that. We're going to begin tonight's concert with a piece that is really special and speaks to the title of these concerts and the moment that we're living in. Last quarter, we sang almost entirely music not by white male composers. And a highlight for everyone was singing a piece called The Lamb by a young Filipino-American composer named Matthew Lyon Hazard. So I asked him to write a new piece for us specifically for these concerts. And he wrote both the text and the music. It was originally supposed to be for two choirs back and forth, but you'll hear as he set the text to the music, it actually winds up being mostly the tenors and basses of the choir singing the melody at first, and then the sopranos and altos doing sort of a repetitive ostinato on the word returning, and then that flips, the tenors and basses are singing flight, 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 while the sopranos and altos. So it's sort of a back and forth between the sections of these choirs. It's a personal piece. It's about Matt Lyon Hazard being in a long-distance relationship during COVID, and that thought of sitting on the tarmac on the airplane waiting to go see your lover, and being on an airplane that can cross continents towards you, which is the title of these concerts. But it's a beautiful text and it's a beautiful thought, and I think during COVID, this is where so many of us are in our lives. We're in a long-distance relationship with so many of the things that we love in our lives. And we're waiting for technology, which might be an airplane or might be a vaccine, that can reunite us not just with the people we love, but with the things we love. Here's the text that Matthew wrote, and then you're gonna hear us sing it. This is the world premiere performance of Flight. The flight from my side of the world to yours fills me with anticipation. My skin prickles, reaching out to your hand, and has forgotten the long-held fear of flying. Every touch, every scent that reminds me of you brings me closer to us. Launch jitters jolt the cavernous cabin. The breath of the powerful engine fills the air, its force pushing me into my seat, and we embrace the sky. The world passes slowly beneath the shivering silver fin of the skybird. and now it grows smaller, small enough for me to step across continents towards you. Enjoy the world premiere of Flight by Matthew Lyon Hazard.
Thank you.
The next two pieces we're going to sing for you were both written centuries ago in the Baroque period, and they were written for two antiphonal choirs to sing back and forth to each other. And occasionally the choirs sing together, sometimes they overlap, sometimes they alternate. It's been quite a challenge for PSU Chamber Choir to literally rehearse these in separate rooms and combine just in time to try to put them together in this echoey church. The first one is a madrigal by Giovanni Gabrielli with a libretto by Torquato Tasso, and it's incredibly intimate. It's called Dormiva Dolcemente, and it's about seeing your lover just taking a nap and thinking, what am I doing? Time's a-wasting. And you give your lover a kiss, and as it says in the poem, then the doorways to paradise open. And it's just such a touching and fragile moment. And to find that moment in a group of 40 who are in masks and distanced, I'm so grateful for the students found this in their hearts to share this moment. And I think that's how we feel about so much of our lives now. We're separated, and can we seize the few moments that we have together? After this, we're going to sing a religious piece by Johann Sebastian Bach, the last movement of his motet, Singet dem Herrn. A lot of people think this is one of the harder pieces in the choral repertoire, just a praise of God, and it's just a true expression of joy, and it's one of those pieces, it's got so many notes. And first the choirs alternate on this melody back and forth, and then eventually they combine together. And that was supposed to be the whole theme of the quarter. We're going to sing back and forth and hopefully then experience the joy of the two choirs singing together. And you'll see choir one accompanied by Chuck Dillard on the harpsichord, and choir two accompanied by Garrett Bond on the organ. So Gabrielli and Bach for double choir.
Oh,
Portland lost one of its coral icons this past November. Dr. Bruce Brown ran the coral program here at Portland State. He had my job from 1978 until 2006 and built the Chamber Choir into the organization that it is today. A couple other people served after he retired in 2006 before I took over in 2010. But I've got to say, ever since I've taken over this program, he's treated me very much like a son. And a lot of us feel this way about our choirs, that it's not just the individuals in the choir who are part of our family, but the choir itself is an entity that we take care of and we nurture. And for Bruce to stay involved in this program, he taught graduate choral literature for me, he covered rehearsals when I was out of town, he got to know a lot of the graduate students and continued to mentor them. This is a man who was a lifelong teacher and someone who cared deeply about his students and about choral music. He also conducted the Portland Symphonic Choir for many, many years, actually decades in that position as well, and founded Portland's first professional choir, Choral Crossties, mainly consisting of alumni of the PSU Chamber Choir. And even after he retired, his last venture was a group called Coro in Scola, a group of professional musicians, including indeed many of his former students from Portland State, who existed as a professional choir solely to do workshops in public schools and mentor young singers at the very beginning of their choral journeys to show them what they could aspire to later in life. He was a real treasure, and I wish we had had more time with him. We have several tributes to him tonight. The first two that you're going to hear are really ventures from the past. The first is a virtual choir of former students of his that was produced by Coro in Scola, and they'll be singing one of Bruce Brown's favorite pieces, Sleep, by Eric Whitaker, which I think is very appropriate as a tribute to Bruce. And after that, you're going to see a slideshow produced by me and Peter Simon and Bruce's wife, Daryl, and also a thanks to Amber Schroeder, a former student who helped us pull this together. These are some of Daryl's favorite recordings of live performances by the Portland State Chamber Choir and Choral Crossties conducted by Bruce, and slides of those groups live on stage. I saw Bruce Brown and the PSU Chamber Choir at the ACDA National Conference at Carnegie Hall in 2003. It's the first time I had heard of the Portland State Chamber Choir. It still lives in my mind as one of the finest performances of choral music that I've ever heard. And it's one of the reasons that I'm sitting here now. I would have never applied for this job if I hadn't seen that performance and seen not just the dynamism of the choir, but Bruce was tackling some of the hardest music that I could ever imagine and doing it with students, music that I had only previously seen performed by the finest European professional choirs. Everyone I know that was at that performance feels the same way, to hear Poulenc and the Anjul Enika, just incredibly hard music. We're featuring more of the gentle and beautiful music on this slideshow, but Bruce always had the highest standards, not just of how well a choir could sing, but the kind of music that they could sing and the difficulty level. And it's something that has really inspired me as I've tried to follow in his footsteps of how I guide the students here now. Bruce, thank you for everything you've done for Portland State and for the choral community in Portland. We miss you and we love you.
I'd like to close with Sleep.
Be and sleep.
This next piece will be a little more personal, and I also want to dedicate it to Bruce. It's from some of the current members of the choir, and it's by a local Portland composer, Joan Shimko, who's a good friend, and I know Bruce knew her as well. It's a setting of a prayer by St. Teresa of Avila, Nada te turbe. Don't let anything disturb you. Don't let anything frighten you. All things are passing. It's going to be conducted by one of the current graduate students, Simon Nissen, with about half the chamber choir, and it's accompanied by our cello professor, Hamilton Chaffetz, who was a colleague of Bruce for his entire tenure at Portland State University. When Bruce retired in 2006, Pat and Trudy Ritz made a large donation to establish the Bruce Brown Scholarship. When I first arrived at Portland State, it was the only scholarship I had to offer, a full scholarship for an in-state student, to study music education and be a member of the chamber choir. Thanks to the generosity of many of you watching tonight, we actually have quite a bit more scholarship money. But again, if you're enjoying tonight's performance or would like to do something in memory of Bruce, please make a donation. We'll show you both the link you could use or the number you can text to provide scholarships for the students who sing in choir here at Portland State. If you'd like to consider something larger, like the Ritzes did, to have a scholarship that will live on in perpetuity, or to add to the principle of the Bruce Brown Scholarship so that it can support more than one student, let me know. Literally, just send me an email, ethansperry@gmail.com, or go on the PSU website and find me. I don't think there are many better causes out there to support than the students you're seeing sing for you tonight and we will see sing for you tomorrow. All things are passing. Love never changes. Nada te turbe. Thanks so much for tuning in tonight. We've come to the end of our program. We just have one more song for you, but it's quite a thrilling song and a piece that we premiered a number of years ago that I wanted to bring back to life this year when we got a chance to do a video shoot outdoors at the Lanzhou Chinese Garden. With COVID precautions, originally we didn't know if we were going to be able to record indoors, so I wanted to find some of the most beautiful outdoor locations we could, and we're really grateful to the Chinese Garden for inviting us in and actually closing the garden for part of a morning so that we could do this video shoot. If you haven't been to the Lanzhou Chinese Garden in Northwest Portland, it's one city block of just all this amazing foliage and tile patterns and rock sculptures and bonsai and this amazing lake with koi in it. And it's one of the most peaceful, beautiful, exquisite places, and it's right in the middle of an urban downtown. It's a real testament to how you can create beauty and serenity in the midst of, well, the chaos of a downtown American city. And the Lanzhou Chinese Garden is also a place where a lot of cultural mixing goes on. In fact, a lot of the donations to create the Chinese Garden came from Portland's Japanese community and white community. And so in that spirit of cultural mixing, we decided to perform an Indian raga called Blossoming Lotus, written by a young man named Shiva Bharadwaj, who's now 22, but he was 15 when he wrote the piece. He wrote it together with one of his instructors and a violin professor named H.M. Bhaskar. Shiva wrote the rhythms, Bhaskar wrote the melodies, and then I helped them both flesh it out to become a choral piece. And you'll see Shiva playing the mridangam on this piece. That's the sort of barrel-shaped drum from South India. And Shiva uses this piece to teach us two of the most complex concepts in South Indian music, what's called Carnatic music. The second half of the piece is constantly a back and forth between us speaking rhythms out loud and then singing those rhythms with pitches. So stuff like tuk-a-dee-me, tuk-a-juna, tuk-a-dee-me, tuk-a-juna, tuk-a-dee-me, which becomes tuk-a-dee-me, tuk-a-juna, tuk-a-dee-me, tuk. So you'll hear this call and response where the sopranos and altos will call out a rhythm and then the tenors and basses will sing it back or vice versa. That's the second half, and that's the simpler concept. The first half is this very complicated concept in Indian music called rhythmic dissonance, where the piece is based on a traditional 8-beat cycle, but the choir moves to singing in 7 while the beat gets kept in 8. And you'll see Indian audiences keep time on their hands. The 8-beat cycle is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Or if we use the Carnatic syllables, ta, ka, di, mi, ta, ka, ju, na, ta, ka, di, mi, ta, ka, ju, na. And the Indian audience is expecting the music to move off of that cycle, so they keep time with their hands so they can hear that rhythmic dissonance. You'll see the choir keeping time on their hands. The 7-beat cycle that Shiva wrote sounds something like ta, din, tum, ka, ta, din, tum, ka, ta, din, tum, ka, ta, din, tum, ka, tum. And if we get this right, these cycles should sync up every 7 beats. So you put these two things together and you get ta ding tum ka ta ding tum ka ta ding tum ka ta ding tum ka tum. One more time. Ta ding tum ka ta ding tum ka ta ding tum ka ta ding tum ka tum. Enjoy Blossoming Lotus. Thanks for tuning in tonight, and we hope we'll see you again tomorrow. Thank you.
Oh.